Now that we've kind of broadly understood what is self-esteem and how does our food intake play a role in it, we've come to another element and that is decision making. Decisions, as you know, are nothing but choices that we make day in and day out. So let's hear it from Shweta on how we can make conscious choices in our life. Over to you, Shweta.
Thanks, Akshay. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for spending your Friday afternoon and evening with us. It's such a pleasure to have you all here. So as Akshay said, yeah, we've already seen what is self-esteem, how to awaken it. And then Isha has already told us how food and lifestyle and self-esteem are intertwined. And I'm going to be talking about decision-making and self-esteem. But before we get into that whole thing, I want to understand from all of you, what is your typical decision-making style or approach? Is it casual, rational, impulsive, whatever? Can anyone unmute themselves or chat or, you know, tell me what is your typical decision-making style?
Impulsive.
One? Okay, anyone else?
Ritika also says impulsive.
Okay, anyone else?
Sometimes it is impulsive and sometimes take too much time thinking. I overthink a lot.
Okay, and what? How do you decide when are you going to be impulsive and when are you going to overthink? Meghna?
Yeah.
How do you decide when?
Because I lost.
When are you going to be impulsive? And can you hear me now? Okay, so how do you guys decide? I can see y'all implement a mix of decision making style. So how do you decide when to use which style?
Situation based.
Okay. So let me put it to you this way: will you use the same kind of time and effort to select a pencil, and the same kind of time and effort to select a life partner? Will it be the same?
No,
right? Difference being that if my pencil goes wrong, I'm cool with it. If my life partner goes wrong, I'm gone. Right? So every choice, every decision that I make has an impact. It has and the magnitude of that impact determines how much of your time you'll invest in it. Is it fair to say that? Yeah, okay. So we know that our decisions have a particular consequence. We are aware of this concept, and accordingly, we will invest ourselves in deciding something. Okay. Now, that being said, what according to y'all is a decision? What is a decision? Anybody? You can unmute yourselves. You can chat, put it in the chat box. What is a decision?
It's making a choice.
Right. Anyone else? It's a choice. And anyone else would want
to
go?
I have to stick to that choice.
Okay. Anyone else? Anyone else? Go and explain.
To me, it means taking a final action in that direction.
Okay. So can I present a perspective on what a decision is? So I would agree with Shifalika. I too would say that a decision is nothing but a choice. Okay. In every minute, every moment, we are all making a choice. We're choosing one thing over the other. You all chose to be here. We chose to speak at this event rather than being anywhere else. So it is a choice that we are making every moment. And the choice that you make in a particular moment defines how that moment is going to turn out. So basically, if I choose to be here, in this moment, I am here, you are here, this is our reality. So every minute, the choice that I make, the decision that I make is shaping my moment, and life or reality is nothing but a string of these moments. So then, can we say that my decisions or choices create my reality? Are we on the same page here? Everyone? Yeah?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, cool. So now that being said, so we know that our decisions create our reality. And as we know, today's topic is decision making and self-esteem, but we're going to lead to it. Okay, I'm going to lead you to it. So now we just saw that decisions or choices create our reality. But before we see how that happens, there is one thing which is like the most powerful tool all of us have, which we've all been blessed with, okay? But we don't really understand its significance a lot of times, which is an unfailingly proficient tool which helps us with perfect decision making, okay? And that is intuition. Can anyone tell me what, according to them, is intuition? What is intuition? Anyone would want to share?
It's the gut feeling.
Okay. Anyone else? You know, we always say, I intuitively felt this. I instinctively knew this. What is that?
It's a knowing.
It's a knowing. Okay. Anyone else?
Is it divine calling?
Okay.
Okay. Archana says prediction.
Okay, we'll come to that.
It's an instant thought that comes, like instant reaction that comes without applying too much of logic or thought into it. Like just an instant feeling.
Right. So intuition is nothing but your true voice, the voice of the true you. And what do I mean by the true you? You are not the body. Like how Ruta said, you are the inner divinity, the gold, that is who you are. And intuition is that voice which comes from the real inner divinity, the real you. So here is how we all know of the source energy or the creator or the higher power, you know. And that's like divine consciousness. Think of it like a big ball of light and love and energy. And our true selves are nothing but a fragment of that divine source. We are all fragments of that divine source who reside within the body. Okay? Which means that we embody all the attributes of that divine in a drop. It's like picking up seawater in a drop. It'll still be salty because it belongs to that whole sea. Same way, we are a fragment of that divine consciousness, that higher power. So basically, the true us is a fragment of that divine, which means my inner voice is nothing but the voice of that divine. It's the voice of that higher power. So if I'm always in consultation with that higher power, or with myself, which is connected to that higher power, the chances of me going wrong or making mistakes is less, right? I would totally know always what's right for me because I'm in tune with myself. I'm in touch with myself. Okay, so basically intuition is nothing but your true voice, the voice of the real you. But we as human beings are so used to the tangibility of it all. No, we need to touch it. We need to see it. We need to feel it. Otherwise, it's not real. If I can't see it physically, it's not there. A lot of times that is what is prevalent right now, that agar dikhta nahi hai, toh bikta nahi hai. You know, it's that way, literally, at the cost of sounding crude, but this is what it is. But that is not true. This is coming from a very subtle energy. You know, your divinity is very subtle. But it is not like, oh, if you can't hear us, then fine, go to hell. It's not like that. So the divine consciousness has devised a way for us to recognize its signs and symptoms in physical terms through bodily symptoms. Now let's look at the next slide. I'll just take you through this. So supposing you are at a juncture where you are making a decision. You want to know, you know, what is right for you, what is not right for you, whether a situation, a relationship, a job, whether it's right for you or not. Okay, now supposing you are in tune with your intuition. Intuition is nothing but the voice of the self, the real you, right? So you're in tune with your intuition. If you experience any of this, nausea, tummy ache, so you're about to make a decision, but these are the signs you're getting. Tummy aching, a sense of being choked, feeling emotionally low, anxiety and or panic, heart racing, 100% sign that it is not in your highest interest. There is no two ways about it. This is just how it is. It is not in your highest interest. And this is literally how you feel, like completely tight and choked and, you know, breathless. Literally. And that's why I've had to use this red color to kind of be emphatic about the level of red flags that these signs signify. On the other hand, if there's excitement in the heart, tears of joy, a sense of contentment and joy, goosebumps, butterflies in the tummy due to excitement, like overall a happy feeling or a feeling, you can be a little nervous, but you'll know, you'll feel good about it, then you know that it is in your highest interest. Okay? And you'll be totally at peace with everything that you are about to embark upon. So this is how the divine consciousness has decided that you start paying attention to these signs, trust these signs. It's not just your imagination, it's real. Okay, but this calls for you to go beyond your physical senses, you know, because physical senses are exactly that, right? They're conical, they end here. Whereas this is the infinite view you get from that infinite source. So you know exactly what is happening. Okay, so basically what happens is when you are in tune with these, in tune with your intuition, and when you start paying attention to these signs and symptoms, and you know, start trusting them instead of discarding them, is how you get closer to your real self, because you are in touch, acknowledging it. And that is what helps you gauge situations, people, circumstances, relationships, and the majority of the elements in your external environment. We are always bothered about our decisions, right? Did I choose a life, right life partner? Am I in the right job? You know, did I choose the right course? It's outside always, right? So this is what, you know, will help you decide what exactly is right for you and what isn't. This is just the beginning. So it's about starting to recognize the intuition. Of course, it gets deeper as your bond with your intuition, with yourself enhances. There will be more signs, but this is a good start, good place to start. Now, before we proceed, I would like to, jump into a small activity. You don't need a pen and paper for this one. So this is how to just learn to trust your intuition. So to begin with, I would want you all to think of a situation where you are looking, I mean, you don't know whether it is right for you or not. So you're looking basically for a yes, no answer. And for those who don't have such a situation or a decision to make, and if you have any situation where you are, say, you don't know how to move ahead or you don't know what to do, you think of that situation. And once everybody has thought of such a situation, please let me know. Akshay, please let me know if everybody's.
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks.
Then Rujita says she's done.
Okay.
Even Ram Gopal is saying he's done.
Okay.
Okay, people are done. I think, yeah.
Okay, all done? Cool. Now, I'm going to ask you a question, but before I ask you the question, there is a rule, okay? It's like a promise I'm literally going to extract from you all. And that is, once I ask the question, you have to notice and trust the first answer, first feelings, thoughts, visual images, bodily sensations that come to you, even if it is not what you want to hear, see, or feel. No thinking, no analyzing at all. Okay, this is for your own good. So do I get that from you? Even if it doesn't make sense. Do I get that from everyone? Do I? I'm assuming I do. I hope I do.
Yes, Shweta.
Okay, great. Thanks. So now I want you all to close your eyes, because the questions I will read out to you. Okay? Eyes closed. So in the case where you're looking for a yes, no answer for that situation, I want you to ask yourself this question. Is this particular situation, describe the situation, in my highest interest? Yes, no, first feelings, first thoughts, whatever comes to you, you don't have to share it. And for those who don't know what to do in a particular situation, you will ask yourself, in this particular situation, what is the choice that aligns with my highest interest? First feelings, first thoughts, images, visuals, note it all. You just have a few seconds because this doesn't take longer. Once you have your answers, let me know. You don't have to share these answers, so relax.
Yes.
All done?
Yep.
Got your answers? Great. So this is what your intuition is about. Is the first split second, as Shefalika had mentioned, is the first split second. Anything after that is your mind playing games. Okay. So whenever you want to make a decision, so of course you start with small things because it's like, you know, if you've never worked out, if you've never done yoga, you don't straight away start with 25 Surya Namaskars. You take it slow. It's the same thing with intuition. You start with small, small things. Should I buy this from this particular shop? Should I buy these vegetables? Are they going to be good for my system or not? And then you build it and take it onto your bigger decisions in life. Another thing that I would want to mention over here is there's no decision that you want to make. This is an exercise where you close your eyes and connect to yourself that you can do for any kind of inner connection. Anything. It doesn't have to be a yes, no answer. It doesn't have to be a solution seeking exercise only. It can be because it's very, very helpful and effective, but it doesn't have to be. So if you just want to even connect to your inner self, find, like, you know, feel what's happening with then you can still do the same exercise and pay attention to what thoughts come to you. Yeah, are we good?
Yep.
Does anyone want to share an experience where they instinctively felt something about a particular situation but went against their inner feeling only to then later feel that, I shouldn't have done it? Anyone wants to share such an experience they had? Anything? Anyone?
Yeah. Okay. I usually drop my dad at the office every alternate day in the morning. Uh-huh. And one morning I felt I don't want to go. I just should not go.
Okay.
But I went against that weird feeling in my stomach. I went. Uh-huh. And I got stuck badly in traffic. I reached home late and I was late for my office work. So okay. I should have not actually gone. It's a small thing, but I vividly remember it.
No, fair enough. Anyone else had a similar experience where they went against their gut and or intuitive feeling and they then felt they shouldn't have? Anyone? Okay, so let me share my experience then. I've had many such experiences, but one of them which comes to my mind is when a few years back, I wanted to look for a dietitian and some of my friends and family recommended this particular person and she just didn't feel right to me.
Gudu, hey, I'm parat kutun ala hai.
Just didn't feel right to me, but I still went ahead with it and enrolled for that program despite not liking it, despite not wanting to, just because everybody was like, oh, come on, no, she's very good. I didn't feel right, but I didn't have a logical reason for it. So I went with it, and within 2 weeks, my body revolted, absolutely protested. And then I was like, I should have just listened to my inner feelings. Okay, now why I give that example and why I brought this up is something that we will cover just in some time. So before that, I want to talk about decision making. We know that decisions or choices create a reality, but there is something called influencers. You know, we all talk about responsibilities. We feel responsible, like you, I think Meghna had said, right? We feel responsible. So there are all kinds of influencers that impact our decisions. So I've just listed down the primary ones here. We have family, like, you know, parents, siblings, relatives, friends, religion and culture, then societal beliefs, values, and expectations. You know, aisa hi hona chahiye, this doesn't look good, that doesn't look good. And they all, before when we are making a decision, that all impacts the decision. And then as we know, this decision that we take, which is impacted, influences this reality, creates this reality rather. But this wins, passes through many filters that we have. Okay. I'm going to be talking about, but there are many such. And that one filter is self-esteem, your sense of self-worth. Okay. Depending on how strong this filter is, the magnitude of this impact will be affected. The stronger the filter, the lesser will pass through. It's like a strain. And the weaker the filter, the more the influence. Okay, that is how it is. Okay. As I said, today we are only talking about self-esteem. There are, and a sense of self-worth. There are many such filters. So now let's understand why we allow these influencers, how they actually impact us. So remember, going back to that example, I said I got coaxed into just going against my gut and going by whatever others were saying for the dietitian. What do you think happened there? What do you think happened there? Why did I just get coaxed?
You would have pressured others' values and opinions more than what you thought about your own opinion.
Yes. Yes, exactly. It is exactly that. It is basically that I am nothing. I don't value myself. I don't even know if I'm capable of making the right decisions. Let me just go by what others are saying. Because if I make a mistake, then I don't want to be blamed and judged. Because there is no confidence. Okay, so basically what I've done is I have completely discarded my sense of self, my opinion about things and myself, and gone by someone else's views of everything. They were family, friends, everything, but still not me, outside of me. Okay, which means there and then I have gone away from the self. Because I'm doing whatever someone else is asking me to do, whatever someone else expects of me. It has nothing to do with who I am. So I've already digressed from the self, which is the intuition, which is the inner divinity. So I've gone away from that. If I've gone away from that, I don't need to really, I will talk about it, right? The best way to make high quality decisions is to be in touch with that. But I've gone away from that. Okay, because I'm actually leading my life based on someone else's views of what is right, what is wrong. And that happens because I have very low self-esteem. Okay, again, if I've completely gone away from myself, that means I've discarded the sense of self. So jo hai nahi, usko how will I value? How will I value something that I don't, for me doesn't exist? For sense of self-worth, I have to acknowledge the self, but I have gone away from the self. So how will I value it? How will I give it that worth? So that is what happened. Okay, because all of us have this universe of people, you know, teachers, colleagues, parents, friends, and their opinion matters. It means the world to us. But at any point in time, we all have a choice. Huh? It's not like everything is just imposed on us. We have a choice that when their opinions come to us, we have a choice at that moment to actually think, is it really true or is it just their opinion? Okay, if we are able to connect to ourselves and say that okay, it's just their opinion, respected but not accepted, then your sense of high self-worth or sense of self-worth is high, and that is established because you actually are evaluating yourself from your own lens. But most of the times we believe their opinion as the truth, because this is how the current era is. This is how the current age is. This is how, the culture has been so far, which again is changing now because eras keep changing. So this is going to change. But as of now, this is how it is. We choose to believe their opinions as our truth, especially if there's something harsh that comes our way, then to patka that, I'm not good only. If my parents say this, or if my friends say this, if my spouse says this, so something is missing in me. Happens a lot of times. Okay. And then again, taking this point forward, if, as I said, I don't acknowledge the self, I don't value myself, okay, then what kind of decisions will I make? Will I make decisions that are in my highest interest? Will I consider myself worth enough to make good decisions or great decisions? What kind of choices will I make? If I've gone away from the self, that means I'm not in touch with my intuition. If I'm not in touch with my intuition, how will I even identify what is in my highest interest? If I don't identify what is in my highest interest, what kind of a reality will I manifest? Are we on the same page? Are you all getting this? Are you all understanding this? Everybody? So far?
Yes.
Cool. Okay. So I will show you what happens when self-esteem is low. It's a cycle. I will show you. But before that, I want to talk about how decision-making and self-esteem are now closely interlinked. Remember in the beginning, I asked you guys that what kind of decision-making style do you have? And based on the consequence of that decision, your style will change. That's what we agreed upon, right, at the start. So now this is the time to talk about that we are all aware that every decision or every choice has a consequence. It has a fixed consequence, okay? But the problem arises is when you don't want to accept that consequence and you don't want to accept this fact. So basically, if you are something like, I will write 2 + 5 = 8 and I want it right also. Won't happen, right? 2 + 5 = 8, you'll get it wrong. That is the consequence. Fixed choice to write 8, get it wrong, fixed consequence. It's just how it is. It doesn't work any other way. So what happens is when your sense of self is not there, that means when you're not in touch with yourself, okay, you are not confident of your decisions. You want to make this choice, but you don't want to accept the consequences of that choice. You want to make decisions, but you are too afraid to face the consequence of the decisions. And you would be, right? Because you don't know, when you don't know what is right for you, who you are, then how will you identify or be sure of identifying what is right for you, right? So you want to make decisions, but you don't accept the consequences. So you're constantly afraid of making the wrong decisions. And so you get influenced by others. You're always making decisions out of fear. And decisions made out of fear are, you know, what you give in, you will get back, right? Choice was fear, outcome will reflect fear. Fear and inner divinity or intuition have nothing to do with each other. Okay. You think about anyone, whatever is divine for you. Have you ever heard any references that, you know, any divine being got away and ran away? Anyone, you can choose to think of any divine being or representation of the divine consciousness. No, right? Fear and divinity don't coexist. Just doesn't happen. Okay. So when you're making decisions out of fear, you're far from your inner divinity, which means you are not making decisions which are in your highest interest. That is one thing. Okay. The second thing that happens when you're away from your self is that you take it to a different level. You completely outsource your life. I don't want to make any decisions. Let someone else decide for me so that I can blame them later. I don't want that headache of taking the blame on myself. This ability or this inability to stand by the consequences of your choices or stand by your decisions comes from chronic low self-esteem. And why I say chronic is because it's deep-rooted in our society. Hota na, that, you know, everybody goes by that general perception that whatever agrees with everyone is right for everyone, including for me. Right? It is like that because, and anyone who's empowered, anyone who speaks their truth is judged, is castigated, is cast out. And we don't want to do that. We want to belong. We want to be accepted always. We don't want to be judged. So we just go with that. And this is exactly the perception we are here to change, that you don't have to belong. You don't have to be like anybody else. Just be you and let anybody else be themselves and learn to coexist. So before I move on, I have to make two caveats. One is that these experiences that you have because of your low self-esteem are meant to be had. There is a higher divine plan at work over here because it's more like a lesson that you learn Only when you are not valued in the eyes of others will you be pushed to value yourself. So that is one thing. It's like a it's like you're pushed against the wall that, okay, up karo. No one else is going to give you that worth. You have to learn to value yourself. And the second thing is when we say don't get influenced by others, we are not propagating stubbornness here. No. We're not saying ki nahi mujhe jo chahiye, I'll do that only baki jao bahar mein. No, that is not what we are saying. We are saying that whenever someone says something to you, anything, you have to get in touch with your inner self. You have to take a pause and evaluate and trust the answers you get from your inner self. That is this really true? Is this really right for me? If yes, then yes. If no, then you tell them that, okay, this is your opinion, but this is not what is right for me. And I'm going to honor that. So that is how it should actually work. Now, let me show you this cycle of what happens when the sense of self-worth is low. So I have my influencers. I have the equation where decisions create my reality. I have a very low self-esteem. So it's highly porous. The strainer is not strong at all. So that's the influence that has started. And a significant amount passes on through my decisions. And chances are that because I'm digressing from myself and getting influenced by others, I'm not going to be very happy with what comes out. Okay. Distressed, unhappy, and feeling low, our chances are high because I have gone away from myself. I discarded myself and blindly just followed what others said. So if I'm not happy with the outcome of my decision, it's going to lower my self-esteem further. And the cycle continues. And this is what we say, patterns in my life. Har jaga, I'm just going through the same thing, same thing. So this is how you face patterns. This is how you create patterns in your life till such time as it gets so much that you are then compelled to do your inner work, or then you know you want to really address this, Kiar, what is happening, why am I experiencing these things in my life, what have I done? And then you will go to there are various modalities which can help you with this and help you break this cycle. On the other hand, when we say our sense of self-worth is high, what happens? There's influencers. We have this equation of decision and reality, but self-esteem is strong. Self-worth will only be high when there is a sense of self, which is your intuition, okay? Your inner voice. What will happen before, when there is influence, I will always check with my intuition. Is this right? How does this agree with me? If yes, then fine. But if no, then accordingly, there'll be a very small portion that'll pass through this filter. Okay, because I'm now in touch with this. This will tell me how much needs to pass through. And then that's the reality I will have. So now I'm addicted to being happy. So then this will boost my self-esteem and I will be encouraged to again get in touch with myself before, making any decisions, because I like feeling this way. I do. So I will make sure that this is how I feel. And so this is how you create a new cycle, a new reality. Any questions so far? Any questions so far?
No, I don't think people have posted.
No? Okay. Can I go ahead then? Okay, I'll go ahead. So I would need y'all to have a pen and pad next to y'all for the next activity that we're going to be doing. So let me know if everyone has a pen and pad, then I can start.
Yes, I think we can.
Yeah.
Okay. Does anyone need the?
Okay.
No, people have said, yeah. People have it. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. 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 So, this is an activity we're going to do. It's rewind to relearn. Again, the activities here you will not share with anybody because it's about being very honest with yourself. Here is what I want you to do. Okay. Try and recall an instance from your early days when you believed someone else's opinion of you or anything to do with you, and preferably not a nice one. And its impact on you. So just try and recall that episode, and it could be anything. It doesn't have to be from it could be from any age, whatever you can recall. And these are the questions you will answer. You'll ask yourself an answer. How old were you? Who was present with you? What was said to you or spoken of you? How did it make you feel? Did you think those words impacted you in a way that would attribute to your current nature? Did you make any decisions in that moment? And what kind of a relationship would you say you share with that person today, if at all? So I'm going to leave this on. You can take about 8 minutes to do this. Akshat, that's fine on time, right?
Yep.
Yeah, so you can take about 8 minutes to do this. When you all are done, please let me know. And once you have these answers, think of one or two more episodes following this episode, which made you feel similar things. And once you're done with that, let me know. So now just go through those answers that you've got. Okay, just read them. And every emotion that you felt, I want to tell you that it's a choice you made. You chose to feel it that way. You chose to perceive things that way. Just become aware of it. You don't have to do anything about it. You just have to be aware of this, that others were not responsible for how you felt. You chose to feel those things. No matter how it looks right now, that aise kaise, aisa hi, you chose to feel them. It doesn't make you bad or doesn't make you like, you don't blame yourself. You take responsibility for your emotions. Okay? So the second part to this activity or exercise is something you take away with you, which I will email this slide to each and every one of you after this event, because the second part of this activity is something you reflect on in the days to come. It will not happen in 5 minutes or 2 minutes or 10 minutes. So I'm going to put the questions up right now, but don't worry. I will be mailing it to all of you, so you will have them with you even after the event. Okay. With today's understanding and awareness of how self-esteem plays a role, and how there could be other emotions also, but we're talking about self-esteem today. Do you think you could have perceived these episodes in an alternative way? In a very objective view that you could actually give to this entire situation where you answered the questions 1 to 7. The second thing is, which of your filters do you think were at work? What made you perceive what was said the way you did? And now that you've identified your filters, should a similar episode happen today, how do you think you would choose to respond? This is not something you can do in 5 minutes now, as I said. I will be mailing this to all of you, and you will then reflect on this. This entire slide I will mail to all of you. Idea being that, okay, what you did back then, you did back then. You don't have to continue doing it. Okay, at least become aware of what was at play within yourself, which allowed that situation to impact you the way it did. That's about it. Okay, anyone who's not understood these questions can ask now, because then I'll move on otherwise. Yeah, okay. Okay, so then again, the next question is then, okay, fine. We know that being in touch with our reality and being in touch with our intuition, our inner self, our real self is the best way to make the right decisions, and decisions is what create our reality. So then how do I do that? How do I create a reality that aligns with my highest interest? There is only one way, okay? You have to acknowledge yourself. You have to get in touch with your inner divinity, your true self, your core. That is who you are. Only when you are in touch with who you are, will you be able to identify what is right for you. Otherwise, you will be living another's perspective. You won't be in touch with yourself. So that is the key. Which, before I continue, I would like to make a reference to Insha's section of the talk. When we talk about low self-esteem and no sense of self, low sense of self-worth, it actually means that my decisions in everything are not in my highest interest, including my food, which is where my body, my mind, and my inner divinity all have lost alignment. Okay, they're not in alignment with each other. So there has to be an alignment. There has to be a realignment rather at every level. That's crucial. My body and my mind have to align to my inner divinity, because my inner true self knows what is right for the body, knows what is right for my mind. And that is how I will make decisions that completely align with me and manifest a reality that is in my highest interest. Because don't forget, intuition is not just a thing. It's a superpower, literally. It is like an anchor that connects you to that source and keeps you anchored on your path. It won't let you go astray. In fact, I call it the GPS, the inner GPS, a lot of times. But the GPS can fail, but this won't. It's that proficient. So the only way to, create a reality that aligns with you is, all you need to do is just choose to walk back to your true self. How do you do that? Start connecting to your intuition, start trusting it, start working with it. That exercise that we did, the 2-minute exercise, you can do it in any situation. The more the better. Start off small and then, replicate it across other situations and then take it big. That's how you will start building a relationship with yourself, your inner voice. Okay. And then once I create a reality that aligns with my highest interest, then what are the symptoms of living such a reality and the side effects once I have created that? Let's see that. So firstly, you'll find yourself making decisions from a place of faith and a sense of knowingness of what feels right to you, right? Because you're in touch with the divine source. What confusion can you possibly have? It has to be in your highest interest. There is no confusion. There is an addiction to being guided by the divine, because we saw that cycle, right? When the sense of self-worth is high, you are happy and empowered, and then you further boost your self-esteem, and then you're again connected to your intuition, and then, you're happy with your reality that you create. So this is what, it'll be like an addictive cycle. We are addicted to things that make us happy, right? It's the same thing. You feel very confident of and guiltless for the decisions you make, because it's between you and you, and you know you're doing the right thing. Then you don't feel a need to justify your actions or decisions, of course. You are aware of the consequences of your decisions, and even if you're not aware of what that consequence is going to be, when you're in touch with yourself, with your intuition, you have this, a power of different kind, or the faith of different kind that whatever in the face of stiff opposition, you are so peaceful that, okay, this is what is right for me and this is what it is. It just doesn't go any other way. So you will have that courage, that confidence to own your decisions. Okay, you make choices without feeling the need to seek the approval or for validation from others. You can seek inputs, but you need not get swayed, or you need not get pushed. Does not affect or influence the choices you make. Because understand one thing, they will look at it from their lens, and you have to look at something from your lens, which is again yourself. Okay. Now, what are the side effects? So once you have created such a reality, what can you experience? You feel empowered, and this feeling of empowerment is a different league altogether. There's newfound harmony. You're at one with yourself. You're at peace with yourself and others. There's a newfound sense of love, respect, and acceptance of yourself, of everything, of everyone, because you're so at one with everything. There's no conflict. You're aligned. Okay. Then you will speak your truth effortlessly and with love, because your intentions are guided by your source. Okay. you will shift from wanting to control everything to just surrendering, because there's faith that a higher power is driving you. So there is a faith, a sense of surrender. And when you lead such an aligned life, the kind of life and reality that you manifest because of this kind of realignment and because of this kind of connection is contagious. People get inspired. They want to be like you. They want to know what this is. How are you doing this? So you will inspire others to realign to themselves. It's like, you know, one candle lighting many others and brightening the entire space, the room. So that is how it is, pretty much. So now summarizing the whole thing, we've seen that we have our influencers, we have a filter, which is our sense of self-worth. If that filter is low, I mean, if it's weak, then we bypass the intuition and we go straight to our decision or choice. And then we have a reality, which is the consequence of that decision or choice, and it will weaken the self-worth. Influencers will again become stronger. Correct? Because the strain has become weak, so the influence will become strong. On the other hand, if our sense of self-worth is high, we will consult with the inner self, the intuition, and then decide. And accordingly, our reality will boost our self-worth, and the influencers will also change, because now they will fall in that category of getting inspired. How are you doing this? How are you creating this reality for yourself? So that is what it is. Now, having seen all of this, there is one more aspect. There are many other things that, you know, part of the self that actually influence and impact your reality. Okay, and I'm just going to touch up a bit upon these various other elements and angles. And those questions are, who am I to begin with? Who are you? You're not the body, as I said, right? You are your inner divinity. Okay, that is who you are. You're not the story that your choices have created. You're not the life that your choices have created. You are the inner divinity. You're constant. Okay, you are a very powerful being with the power of choice. If you don't like your reality, change your choice. You have that power. So that is who you are. And the only change you go through is that you're constantly healing and transforming and growing for your own evolution and growth. Okay. But other than that, that is who you are, your inner divinity, not what your life tells you. And how do I perceive myself? Do I perceive myself as the inner divinity? Or whatever I am, I just completely forget those boundaries and mix myself with my reality. So, you know, a lot of times we say, oh my God, I did this. I'm so bad. You know, no, I did this. What I did is not right. That doesn't make me bad. So it's very important to get that detachment, that perspective, like objectivity. You just step back that, oh, I am the inner divinity. I am not what I did. So you are not what you do. That is not who you are. They're two different things. So when you get that objectivity, when you get that perspective, then you suddenly feel a little more empowered and you're like, oh, okay. So I have the power of choice. So if I am not bad, what I did was not right. So let me change that. Then you change your choices, you change your actions, you change what you do, and that's how you change your life. So it's very important again to realign to yourself, because that's how that objectivity will come. And the last thing, why am I here then? So nothing in the universe is redundant. Everything has a purpose. Everything is exactly the way it should be at the right time in the right place. There is no extraness, if I can say so. It's all perfect. Okay. So that means if you and I are here, we all have a very good reason for being here. And that reason is called life purpose, which may or may not be the same as your career. For some people, their career is only like a job that they do is only their life purpose. For some people, they have a separate career and a separate life purpose. And for some, they have a career, they have a life purpose, but then they choose to drop their career and make their life purpose only. I fall in the third category. I'm an MBA by qualification. I had a job, but then this is my calling. I chose to make this my career, and I left that job. So this is a choice I made. But to be able to identify my purpose, I have to be in touch with me, right? How will I identify what I am passionate about if I don't know who I am? And if I'm not in touch with myself, how will I identify what is right for me and what will give me joy, right? So again, this calls for a realignment to yourself. So think of it as this, okay? There is a piece of magnet that is, say, you, the real you, and there is some iron bars, okay? That's your purpose and everything that is in your highest interest, okay? But in this case, we'll talk about the life purpose. And now, if you put a plastic ball around that magnet, will that magnet attract the iron bars? No, right? So you have to take out that plastic ball. You have to be the raw, authentic you, and then the iron bars or the purpose will get attracted to you. So that is the crux of the whole thing. You just have to remember who you are and get in touch with the real you and just live the real you, just the way it's supposed to be, because that's the only way you can actually manifest a truly fulfilling, blissful, peaceful, happy, content life, just the way you and your higher power intended it to be. That's been my time. Thank you so much for being here, and floor is open for questions. Akshay, if there are any questions, can I stop sharing my screen?
You can stop sharing, yes. I think people, if you have any questions, feel free to either post it in the comments or you can unmute yourself and ask.
Yeah.
Shweta, thank you very much. I kind of agree with that we need to gauge situations by connecting to our bodily symptoms before we make a choice or while we're making a choice.
Yeah, so basically even before you get into the entire evaluation, assessment, decision-making tools, this will actually tell you, just getting in touch with this, whether it's worth the effort.
Right. And I think for that, we need to understand who we are, and this is possible only when we are connected to ourselves. So thank you once again for sharing your inputs on how we need to gauge situations by connecting to our bodily symptoms.
Shweta, I really thank you for inspiring us through your thoughts, stories, and experiences. It's been an insightful day today, and I'm sure many of y'all have similar thoughts. There were so many aspects that I wasn't sure about. I'm going to try all of the tips given by our experts today. But we come to an end of this event, but before we drop the curtains, let me open this forum for any questions that people may want to ask. Since there are no questions, then if you want, you can also write to us on the email ID akshaym@samakshhealing.com or shwetav@samakshhealing.com. We will also send you a feedback form, and it would be great if you could share your views on the event with us. It will help us help you better. Our next event will be scheduled for the month of October, and we will release details of Reflexion 2.0 by September 2020. Till then, please do subscribe our Facebook and LinkedIn pages at Samak Soul Waters, and also subscribe to our channel @SamakSoulWaters. We hope to see you all in our future events. Till then, stay happy, stay blessed. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Hema, for your inputs for this journey. Wouldn't have been possible without you. And for all those who registered for this event, thank you once again for trusting us and being here today. So recording of this event, we will be made available on our social media handles. As Hema also mentioned, while this event focused on awakening our self-esteem, our next event, which is Reflexion 2, focuses on emotions, mainly fear, guilt, and shame, food, and you. And it's scheduled for October 24th. So stay tuned for more updates on that. Have a great evening and an awakened life ahead. Thank you again.